This is Megha here, and thank you for joining us for this exciting session today as a part of the People Matters SME Talent Week. This session, we have with us Ester Martinez, CEO and Editor-in-Chief, People Matters, unveiling the key findings from a first small and medium enterprise HR landscape survey. I will briefly set the context before we move on to the session. Our first research on HR landscape in small and medium enterprises was conducted between December and January, and we witnessed responses from 135 unique companies. The objective of this study was to benchmark and understand key priorities of HR departments, their readiness to tackle challenges, and their approach to various people processes among small and mid-cap organizations across sectors in India. Let me also take the opportunity to welcome Ester for this session. Ester, it is great to have you with us, and thank you for taking our time to launch the research and share its findings with us. We urge our viewers to use the comment box next to the video to share your views and comments on the topic, and also any questions that you may have for Ester. We will try and take up as many questions as possible at the end of this session. You can use hashtag SME Talent on social platforms to share your learnings. Without much further delay, let me hand it over to Ester to take us through the session. Over to you, Ester.
Thanks, Megha. Thank you very much. And good afternoon to all of you who are joining us for the SME Talent Week. It's very, very exciting. This is the first time that we are doing a virtual conference, and I can thank you all for taking your time to join us. And I can guarantee and promise you that you will have a fantastic week ahead of a lot of exciting learning. So this session specific, as Megha was sharing, is really about launching the SME HR Landscape Study 2017. As part of the SME Talent Week, really the objective was to bring the community together of growing companies and understand what challenges do they face. And this study really that I'm going to be presenting to all of you right now was the foundation of our agenda. It helped us create the different sessions that we wanted to take you through throughout the day. And it's also going to be the foundation for our March issue, People Matters magazine March issue, that will compile a lot of the key findings and key learnings as well of the SME Talent Week. So I'll invite you all to make sure you grab a copy of the March issue of People Matters to get access to all that information. So as Mr. Salunki was setting the context beautifully just a few minutes ago, the small and mid-cap companies, diversity of the nature of their business, the composition and their level of probably the maturity in terms of talent has evolved dramatically. And probably is evolving at different rates and different velocities, whether you're talking about the traditional small and mid-cap company or you're looking at companies that are probably starting up today with founders that have had a lot of more exposure to how to run maybe larger organizations. So the talent challenges, I think, are very diverse. What we were trying to do with this study is to really try to find some trends and some key learnings that are common across the growing companies. So just to take you through the demographics very briefly, as Megha was saying, 135 companies participated this year in the study. This is the first time that we're doing it, so we got a really, really fantastic response. The portfolio of industry-specific companies was, again, very balanced. I may say you see a 40% of others there, which basically includes, obviously IT, ITES, followed by manufacturing was the bigger ones. But you have others as well. In the others, you have people from companies from real estate, power, insurance, wholesale. You don't see all that because the distribution was very large. But just to show you that was a very diverse group of companies. In terms of the employee strength, again, very balanced. When we look at small and mid-cap companies, we're looking at 5,000 employees. That's the definition that we have taken. And if you see the distribution is very balanced. In terms of companies that had operating across multiple locations, both in India and abroad, we had a good mix of, again, companies operating only on India was 26%, across multiple locations, 50% in India, and then 24% of companies participating having multinational locations as well. In terms of annual growth, almost 60% are above 15 crores of turnover, but the majority was really about the 50 crore So that's just to give you a little bit of an overview. What we're going to do, in what we aim to cover in this study was, one, what is the talent priorities and the talent challenges? Two, we wanted to focus a little bit about where is the technology maturity level from the perspective of the small and mid-cap companies. And the third was going a little deep dive into the different HR processes. So we looked at hiring, we looked at performance management, we looked at the different areas of the verticals of talent, and I'm going to take you through the findings in a minute. So let's start with the first. So if we need to highlight the top seven challenges, which you can see in the screen right now, there are really main three themes, which I'll take you, but it's interesting to note, and this is not in the slide, but it's interesting to note that when we ask the challenges, hiring people with the right skills did not come in the top challenge. It was actually interesting to note that SMEs are very positive to believe that they can actually hire the right skills. But if you see, the number one challenge is really about attrition. It's really about retaining people that we are able to hire. You may argue, and we didn't ask that in this year's study, and maybe that's something that we'll ask next year. You may argue that whether we are actually hiring the right people, whether you're hiring the right fit, and whether the fact that we are hiring people with the right skills, but not necessarily with the right culture fit, may be one of the reasons why retention or attrition is a challenge. So let's look at these challenges one by one. The first one is, as I was saying, retention. Urgent and both not ready. When I was reflecting and looking at the data with the team, we were really thinking that retention is actually a lag indicator, is a result of probably the other challenges that I mentioned in the screen. So whether it's engaging and motivating or developing leaders, creating a dynamic environment of learning, or providing an employee-centric policy or employee-centric value proposition, it's probably something that is leading to the lack of retention. But it's 73% of participants said that managing retention is a big challenge. 43% said that is a really urgent component, and 45% said this is something that I'm not ready or I'm not equipped to deal with. The second challenge which emerged here, which is probably something that, again, we have heard not only in the small and mid-cap companies, but I think it's something that, unfortunately, it's a reality across the board, is how do I motivate employees to go the extra mile? So again, here, 43% of organizations are saying, I am not ready or equipped to be able to deal with that. The third piece, which is the technology piece, I think the HR community overall, any organization, not only the small and mid-sized companies, but across the board, HR is a very under-invested function when it comes to technology. And we see this very clearly as well in this report. 49% are saying, well, I'm not ready or I'm not equipped to really find what is the HR technology that's more relevant to my needs as an organization. So as we go deeper into HR technology, and I want to spend a few minutes there before we go to the other verticals of HR, where are SMEs using technology today? No surprise there to see that majority of organizations are using technology on HR operations, which is, again, building efficiency to the system and not really looking at the business effectiveness. If you see some of the areas that are less invested in when it comes to technology, you will find still learning and development a huge opportunity, employee engagement a huge opportunity, reward and recognition, and succession planning, which you may argue that these are probably the most strategic levers when it comes to talent management. The ones that actually have more investment on technology is the HR operations. I was saying 36% of companies actually tell us and share with us that they have an integrated HCM tool. Only 36%. I think in today's day and age where there are so many products available in the market, to really realize and reflect about 30%, 36% of the companies that participated only have an integrated HCM technology. So huge opportunity for this function in this particular sector of size of companies to really invest in technology and leverage the power of technology, not only on HR operations and building efficiencies of HR, but also really looking beyond that and looking at what are the levers that build effectiveness, not to the HR as a function, but to the people lever of the business. So I'm going to stop here. If there are questions, I'll be happy to take them, but I'm conscious about time. So I'm going to move to the next piece, which is about the other areas of HR that we cover in the study. We looked at hiring and onboarding and what SMEs are doing in this space. We looked at performance management. We looked at learning and development, and we finished with HR operations, again, to go deeper about where are the areas of concern there. So let me start with the first one, hiring and onboarding. And as I was sharing with you in the beginning of this session, 73% of companies are saying, I'm able to hire the right skills. It surprises me to see that optimistic number because it doesn't really resonate with my empirical discussion when I speak to many of you who are listening to this. 70% are saying, I am optimistic that I can recruit the right skills. It's probably really about whether we are asking, are you optimistic that you're hiring the right kind of fit for the company? And as I was telling you before, I think there's a correlation between whether we are hiring the right people and hence whether that's resonating and finally implying into higher attrition for our business. Now, when we ask the organizations what is the most useful sources of sourcing talent, referrals is number one, followed by job portals and followed by social, and last was consultant. Referrals is no surprise. We have seen an upsurge of more technology players coming in the referral space because there's a natural mirroring on what's actually happening in the social dynamics of the organization. Small organizations will tend to have cultures which are very unique and very well defined, and hence or employees that resonate with that culture, they're probably great brand ambassadors. So referrals is the number one, and I'm not surprised to see that. When we ask them about how do you do onboarding, interesting to see that companies do have a formally documented onboarding program. So there is a maturity in terms of understanding that the formal onboarding is critical. 32% though don't have it documented. It probably happens more of an ad hoc manner. And 8% said we don't have an onboarding program at all. So I think onboarding is done with seriousness, and probably because it's probably owned by the recruitment and the hiring manager together. So as we move to the second pillar, which is the performance review, when we ask the participants how important is performance review, 96% of companies said it's really, really important, and we have a performance review process, and it's key for our business. So I think it's very, very clear that, and Mr. Salunke was also referring to that in his speech in the previous session, it's really, really important to focus on productivity and performance. So performance management is a key function, and it doesn't come as a surprise here. 77% of organizations that participate in have a formally documented process. 16% says we do have it, but it's not documented, and only 7% said we don't have a process at all. Now, the question here, and we saw it earlier, is that how much of that process is actually technology-enabled, and we saw a very small number there, with almost, I think it was around 60% don't actually have a technology underpinning this, and here is what you see the data below. Majority organizations, almost 65% of them, actually use this offline, whether it's in Excel, Word, or whatever other tools. Only 36% actually has a centralized tool. So here is a huge opportunity, I think, for organizations to really look at building efficiency and effectiveness to this process. Now I'll move to the third pillar, which is L&D. Capability building is a huge component on scaling the business. So how are you today building leadership development at the top level? So 32% says we have a formally documented process. 34% says, yes, we do it, but we don't have a formally documented process. And equal number is pretty much one third as well saying that we don't have it at all. So again, a huge opportunity for all of you who belong to the small and mid-cap service, small and mid-cap companies, to really look at leadership development, because not only that creates probably a retention mechanism, but also it creates a succession pipeline, which is so relevant for continuity of business. And it in turn probably creates more rhythm in the organization. So we can see an opportunity here for many of you who are attending this session to reflect about where do I fit? Do I fit in the first bucket or the second one or the third one? And hence, what am I going to do about it? The last part, which is the one that is probably more mature, is the HR operations. Here, only 10% of SMEs said that we still use paper-based. Of course, that will depend on which process are we talking about, but we see some level of automation has happened in different processes of HR automation. Most SMEs have less than 50% of work done through paperwork, and 41% of SMEs rate their HR capable. What I'm trying to say is that when you reflect of how capable you are in able to fulfill the operations, 26% of them says need work. So I think what we see in this slide is two parts: is how much are you still using paper, and how capable you think your function is. And we can pretty much, I think, see a correlation in terms of maturity. Organizations that need more work or they feel that the capability is less probably are those HR functions that have not invested enough time to try to automate, to try to streamline, and to try to build process pinned up with technology at the end of the experience to the employee and the business. So I think very briefly, I think just wanted to use this first 15-20 minutes of our session to deep dive into some of those findings. I think it's a huge opportunity for small and mid-cap companies to invest in more mature processes. It's very clear the more and more CEOs we speak to, there's very strong clarity on how we look at people as an investment, and not only people from, you know, the hiring perspective, but also when we bring them on board, what is the kind of experience, what's the kind of processes, and what's the kind of technology that we have underlying and underpinning really the whole talent experience. So what we're going to do now is I wanted to brief you a little bit about how some of those areas will be covered during the week. So we do have sessions that are going to happen on the hiring piece. So for some of you who are interested, those will happen across the across the week. We will have sessions as well on performance management and on employee engagement. And we will have sessions as well on how do we build leadership and alignment of teams. So I'm going to stop here. And of course, we have sessions on technology and analytics. I'm going to stop here to see if we've got questions, Megha, from the audience, and then maybe I can go deeper in any of the areas that the audience would like me to go from the report perspective.
Sure, absolutely, Ester. Thank you so much for that. We've gotten great response in our comment section. There are a lot of comments and questions coming up. The first question that we have is from Komal Mathur. The question is, would it be fair to say that SMEs overlook the need for consciously building their brand?
Thank you, Komal. Thanks for your question. It's a pleasure to... Komal and I used to work together, by the way, so it's even a double pleasure because I know her very well. So thanks for your question, Komal. I think when you're talking about brand, I will assume in the context that we're talking about, you're talking about employer brand. I think when you're growing an organization, and I speak to many small and mid-cap companies that are growing, I think there are just so many things that you probably need to deal with from the hygiene perspective, whether it's, you know, really cracking the code of the product and the context of the market fit, whether you're really looking at, you know, finding financing and funding for the organization. And talent is very, very critical. But when it comes to employer branding, it's something that is probably a very long-term investment. It requires a very strong long-term orientation from the management team because you probably won't see the fruits short-term. Traditionally, and I'm talking in a very generic way, small and mid-cap companies who are probably at a very strong stage of growth, they are in that quadrant of urgent and important work. And definitely employer branding is something that is very, very important, but it's probably not so urgent because you don't see the results short-term. So I would agree with you. Majority of our organizations do find it difficult to focus on employer brand. Having said that, I think CEOs which are more committed to the scale and really more committed to long-term growth, they understand the importance of it, and they probably put resources and budgets associated to build a strong employer brand, even though they know they will not see the fruits or ROI in a short term.
Great. So the next question, Ester, is from Dinesh, who's based out of Chennai. His question is, what HR technologies do SMEs use for their HR needs? And I'm picking up this question specifically because I know Dinesh posted the same question during the previous session as well. So that's why.
Thank you. Thanks, Dinesh, for asking this question. I think it's a great question. And the result of our study shares some light there to answer that. But I think it's really about the vision of HR effectiveness and HR efficiency. I think a lot of us as HR professionals look at HR as a function to really look at HR per se, when we really need to think is going beyond and saying, okay, it's not about HR, but it's really about people excellence. It's not about HR excellence, but people excellence. What we see in the study is that majority of investment is going into building HR excellence, which is about making the HR processes faster, making them more compliant, making them more aligned to the needs of the business from speed perspective. But it's really about automating what is already happening outside technology. So whether you're talking about leave and attendance, whether you're talking about payroll, whether you're talking about anything which is of workflow that you can automate and make it easier and more compliant, that's where we see more investments happening. But really the opportunity for HR to add value to business will come on us being able to automate and really being able to build strategic inputs on processes which are more strategic, whether it's L&D, how much blended learning do we use? How much technology do we use to make learning meal piece, to make learning available to employees when they need it and the time they need it for the specific learning need they have? There is a huge opportunity there. Performance management, we have seen a little bit of automation there happening, but I believe it's really, again, picking up whatever we were doing in Excel and putting it in a workflow. But I think there is huge technology innovation happening in the performance management space. And I don't really see a lot of the small and mid-sized companies investing there. And really the third lever will be the succession planning and the most strategic manpower planning, which is being able to leverage analytics and being able to leverage a lot more of the data which is underpinning every other process, not only HR, but even outside of HR. What about your sales data? What about your productivity or workshop productivity at the workshop level? So I think what's happening today, to answer your question very briefly, what's happening today is about automating processes which are outside of the system just to make them more efficient. What I think should be happening more, and I'd love to see a lot more of, is really looking at what are those processes that will impact the business more and really automating and investing in technology on those.
Fantastic. So Ester, a follow-up question to that, and this question is coming from Shankara Rajan. The question is, who drives the technology agenda? Is it HR, IT, operations, or executive leadership?
So my answer is, it depends. But I'll tell you what I have seen evolving. I think originally, if you probably look at technology investments, maybe 10 years ago, or maybe five years ago, actually, a lot of those technology investments were centralized in the technology team, whether it's the CIO or the CTO. It was really the team that was looking at what is required from the organization perspective. What we have started to see, especially with the opportunity that cloud can bring to the table, is that a lot, first is cloud, and the second one is SaaS, or software as a service, or software. That's what really has created an opportunity for other functional leaders to not have such a high dependency on somebody supporting them or maintaining those applications, because those applications today are not sitting on our own servers or our own technology setup, but it's really on cloud, which basically means I can access it wherever I am, number one. And because it's the revenue model of those products are now pay as you go or pay per user. Again, I'm able to find my own budget as an HR professional, as an HR leader, and I'm able to create a buy-in for that technology on my own. So what we started to see is the CHRO having a lot more buying power and a lot more influencing power in the decision making of technology. At the end of the day, it is going to be the CEO who is going to have to buy in. So I think what we've seen is more and more CHROs building business cases and doing it in partnership with finance and CIO. So it's not really a decision that is only HR, but there are two things that are happening. Number one is, in many cases, the HR is driving it and building the support from the other functions, both finance and IT, to really go to the business and say, this is the business value proposition on why we should invest in technology in HR. The second thing we have seen is in some organizations that maybe the driver is not HR, which is maybe the CIO or the CEO, is that it's a must to have the HR's buy-in. So either HR is the big buyer or the decision maker, or HR becomes the huge influencer, because at the end of the day, it will be the HR team who has to successfully implement the technology and who's going to be responsible to making sure that the success of the investment happens. I think my follow-up comment on that question is really about building the business case. I think each one of you in this call, whether you're business leaders or you're HR professionals, it's the value proposition of technology is not, cannot only be about building efficiencies. It will have to be about what is the impact that it finally has to the business, and your ability to measure that impact and to able to put that business outcome in front of your value proposition will be the number one reason why finally your CEO will say, go ahead and invest in technology.
Wonderful. So we have a lot of questions coming, Ester. So you have to answer all those as much as we can in the short period of time. The next question is from Piyush Govil. His question is, are SMEs reluctant to allocate budget for HR function and HR automation?
So I think it's a follow-up question. So I'll go very brief, because if there are many questions, then I don't want to take too long. I think any business leader, any promoter will be reluctant to any costs unless you can justify and make that cost an investment. I think it's very, very critical to look at those as investments and not as costs. So when you are asking me a question, why do leaders are reluctant to costs? Well, business leaders will always be reluctant to costs. So can you change your argument? Can you change your terminology, your vocabulary, your storyline into a investment? Only then I think you'll be able to successfully allocate budgets. The sharper you are into correlating that investment into business impact, the more successful you will be.
Great. So the next question is from Gurpreet Bajaj. The question is, can MNCs and SMEs learn from each other through organized forums to fasten each other's learning curves?
Thanks, Gurpreet, for your question. So I think we are already doing it. I think this SME talent week that we are organizing for all of you, it's probably the first time where we're seeing not only SMEs, but many of our speakers are also coming from MNCs and people participating in, even in today's call. I will argue, and I don't have the data in front of me, but I will argue that some of them are also coming from larger organizations like TCS itself. So there are those forums, and I think this is a great opportunity, what's happening today. Very difficult to probably get them on a physical forum, and we do that during our TechHR conference. It's our largest conference we do in August. And there we see both small companies and big companies always coming together. But there's a lot of work to be done. So Gurpreet, you're most welcome to help us and volunteer for that.
Okay, so we have questions pouring in. The next question is from Manjeet Kaur. Accepting the HR team as a true strategic partner, who is more reluctant to take the plunge there, conglomerates or SMEs?
So I think the opportunity, when I speak to CEOs, and there's a beautiful report that speaks about how happy are CEOs with us as HR leaders. And it was interesting to note that 80% of them says that my HR team is not strategically included in my transformation journey. So only 2 out of 10 CEOs says my HR team is totally strategic when it comes to my transformation. Considering all businesses are transforming, I think the opportunity is out there for each one of us. Now, the point is that do we take that opportunity or do we wait for that opportunity to come to us? And I think the time, and for many of you who are attending this call and probably being very proactive leaders, you will answer that question equally as I'm going to do for this colleague who's asking. being a strategic partner is all about understanding the drivers of the business. It's really about taking equal accountability for the output of the business. And it's really about taking the same skin of the game on the business outcomes, whether those business outcomes are necessarily correlated with my talent efforts or my talent inputs. May or may not be. But as an HR leader, am I accountable for the revenues to be met? Am I accountable for the profitability of the business, the targets to be met? Whether, you know, that is not only an HR component, but it may be other components as of course are part of it. So I think strategic partnership, the word partnership is going away. I think it's a lot more about, are you a strategic accelerator of business? Partnership to me means that you are taking a passive role in the relationship. You're just partnering. Somebody else is leading and you're just following. I think it's an opportunity to have an equal partnership. And I may argue in many business, especially service businesses, HR can actually have an accelerator or a driving role in the business to say, well, if we could do this differently, then this will be the benefit on profitability. If we could organize ourselves differently, this will be the amount of new products that we could bring to the market. So I think it's accelerator versus partnership.
Fantastic. I had the last question on my list, but I liked the next question that has just come up on the comment section. So I'd like to take that as well before we take the last question. Now, this question says, in young entrepreneur-driven startups and SMEs environment, is there a radical change in the way they view HR?
Yes, I think so. I absolutely think so. And I'll tell you why. In the traditional organizations, and we've seen this in many big companies as well, but I think it's more true in the smaller companies. Smaller companies, the founders and CEOs have understood that if you have a very large ambition for your business, the culture you set, the rhythm you set will be very critical for you to achieve that. And the big component of the culture and the rhythm organization will be the kind of people you hire. So I have seen many, many entrepreneurs who take personal interest in especially the first 50 people that are hired in the organization, because that's really what sets the culture and sets the rhythm. They themselves spend a significant amount of time building and architecting the culture. And they themselves spend significant amount of time on building the next generation leaders. I think what's different with these new generation startups is the ambition for the business. They don't look at their business as a lifestyle business or something that they probably want to pass on to their next generation or the next generation. They really look at this business to become a really large global business. So when the aspiration and the ambition is so large, they understand that besides having a great idea and a great product, and besides having and assuring the great funding that will be required for that idea, they understand that the people piece will be in the trinity will be equally important. So they're able and they're educated and they understand the importance of that, and they're taking huge level of investment of their time and also of making themselves ready to be able to do that. So huge difference for the new companies.
Fantastic. So we'll now close this Q&A with the last question, which actually sums up the entire discussion. We've had this question of multiple times coming up in the comment section. What are the top three trends in the HR space in SMEs according to you based on the survey?
So I think if I were to summarize it in the top three reflections, I'm not going to call it trends, because probably I will need a little bit of time for me to answer that question from trends perspective. And you'll probably see it in my editorial in March, because after the talent week, we'll have a lot of time to reflect on those trends. But if I were to reflect, coming from the study and coming from the overall preparation for the SME Talent Week, the first key piece that has come to reflection is how ambitious is your leadership will determine how much maturity you will have as an HR team. So I think it's very important reflection to see when I work in a small and mid-cap company, as much as I'll be able to do from HR and talent perspective will really be dependent on how ambitious my leadership team is to take the company to the future. So that will be one first key trend. The more ambitious you are, the more you will understand the importance of talent, and the more you will be willing to invest, and the more long-term orientation you will have. That's the first one. The second one will be really about planning and building for the future, which is the capability building. Capability building both ways, in terms of hiring and in terms of really looking what kind of talent we will need and when. And the second is how much of that talent will come from within. So the build versus buy. So we see the SME sector hiring a lot more qualified talent and really understanding that I will not be able to groom talent from within alone, but I'll have to hire talent which is very specialized. So I think that's going to happen, and it's going to obviously impact our employment and create more opportunities for everybody. But that takes me to the third trend, which is hiring people from outside and feeling positive of your ability to build, to buy those skills doesn't necessarily mean that you'll be able to integrate those skills. So I think the third trend will be the importance of modernizing your organization, because the expectation not only from lateral hires that will come to the organization, but also the millennials that are coming on to the workplace will really be to have a very modern workplace. When I say modern, it really means professionally run, where I have leaders that I report to that I admire, where I have access to tools that make my work easy, and the overall experience and the overall opportunity to development. I think that will be the third part. The need to modernize will have to accelerate very rapidly, because I think the mortality rate in a world we operate today, where there's so much competition, there is so much change in the marketplace, there's so much disruption happening in business models, that are all really only organizations that are able to modernize themselves and attract the right kind of talent, that they'll be able to win the competitive war out there. So that will be my three reflections/trends for our readers today.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Ester. We will have to stop the Q&A session here due to paucity of time. But I would request you to please respond to the questions if your calendar permits post the session.
Sure. I'll do it right away.
Awesome. All right. So thank you so much, Ester, for sharing those insightful findings of the research. I think we had an awesome Q&A session. And thank you to the viewers as well for this participation. There has been overwhelming participation in terms of comments and questions. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm sure all of us have taken some great learnings from this session. Feel free to write into us about what you thought and what your key learnings were. You can use hashtag SME Talent on social media to share your learnings. Thank you. The next session in this virtual event is The Power of Technology in Finding the Right Candidate for the Right Job. The session is being taken by Bharat Jayaprakash, who's the head India sales from Indeed India. It's at 4:30 p.m. So do make sure you join in and continue your SME Talent Week learning journey. Thank you all, and have a great day.